Curtain Call at the Seaview Hotel by Glenda Young. Read by Colleen Prendergast. Act 1. Chapter 1. Helen Dexter, landlady of the Seaview Hotel in Scarborough, gazed from her lounge window. She took in the pretty view of the North Bay Beach, where the sea sparkled under a blue sky. It was early September, and the day was warm with late summer heat. She pushed her bobbed brown hair behind her ears. "Come on, you can't sit gawping out of the window all day. You've got guests arriving this morning," she said out loud. "What's that, love?" a voice replied from the hallway. It was Jean, the Seaview's award-winning cook. When Helen and her late husband Tom had bought the hotel, they'd inherited Jean as part of the fixtures and fittings. She was a no-nonsense Yorkshire woman in her early 60s, a dynamo of a woman with short blonde hair and oversized glasses. She was short and dumpy, but woe betide anyone who called her that, as Jean described herself as cuddly. "I'm just talking to myself again," Helen called back. "Don't they say that's the first sign of madness?" Jean bustled into the lounge, where Helen was sitting on the window seat. "It's when you start answering yourself that you need to worry," she replied. Helen swung around to face her. "I've been talking to myself a lot since Tom died, you know. I talk to Suki all the time, but she's not much of a conversationalist."
"Well, that's greyhounds for you," Jean smirked. "Anyway, you've always got me. Any time you want to chat or need a shoulder to cry on, I'm here. And you can talk to Jimmy, too."
Helen turned her head from Jean's inquiring gaze and looked out of the window again. "Jimmy's still away, working on the cruise ship with his troupe of Elvis impersonators."
"Yes, but he's coming back next week, isn't he? You must be looking forward to seeing him again and picking up where you left off. He's a good man, Jimmy Brown. You seem well suited."
Helen picked up a cushion, plumped it and placed it back down. She wasn't ready to talk about Jimmy. He was the first man she'd had feelings for since her beloved Tom had passed away after 30 years of marriage. It felt like she was betraying Tom's memory, and she was struggling with the emotions that raised. However, Jean wasn't ready to let the subject drop.
"I don't understand why you didn't join Jimmy on the cruise when he asked you. It would have done you the world of good to get away."
"How could I have left? I had the Seaview to run," Helen said, more sharply than she intended. She smiled an apology at Jean. "You know how hard I've worked, getting the place decorated and updated over the summer. There was no way I could have gone away. Anyway, I didn't want to. I wanted to stay and cherish my memories of Tom."
Jean held her hands up in surrender. "I'm just saying, you could have done with some time out, that's all. It's been almost a year since Tom passed. It's high time you were moving on. You could do a lot worse than getting to know Jimmy better."
"Sorry, Jean. I guess I'm feeling on edge this morning because of the new guests coming in," Helen replied, happy to change the subject. She'd deal with her feelings for Jimmy when she saw him again. Right now, she had too many other things on her mind. "They sound an odd bunch, this lot arriving today," she went on. "They've booked the whole place for a solid 2 weeks."
"An odd bunch? In what way?"
Helen laid her arm along the top of the window seat. Jean sat opposite, straightening beer mats on a tabletop and turning them right way up. Helen appreciated her attention to detail. "They're a theatrical group. They've booked 8 rooms, though only 7 people are coming to stay. They said they need one room to keep props and costumes in."
Jean's eyebrows shot up in surprise. "You didn't tell me they were actors."
Helen shrugged. "I didn't think you'd be interested. They're rehearsing a play that's going on at the Modernist Theatre on the seafront in 2 weeks' time."
"Really? I'm sure I read in the Scarborough Times that the Modernist was in danger of closing down."
"Well, the play our guests are putting on is the last chance to save it, so there's a lot riding on it. If the play's a success, sells enough seats and the audience returns, my friend Taylor says it'll be saved."
"How is Taylor? I haven't seen him in ages," Jean said.
An image of Taylor Caffrey, theatre manager, came to Helen's mind. He was in his late 40s, a jovial, rotund man with slicked back, black hair that Helen suspected was dyed. He liked to wear a grey pinstripe suit with two-tone brogues and styled his look on gangster films from the black and white era.
He was a well-known, well-liked, flamboyant character about town who contributed to the arts page for the local newspaper, the Scarborough Times. "Is he still living on the Esplanade with his mangy old cat?" Jean asked. "Mr. Phipps, that poor cat must be on its last legs by now, but as far as I know, it's still alive. Anyway, if the play's a success, it means Taylor will have enough money to carry out repairs and keep the Modernist open for another season. That will give him time to apply for grants to pay for repairs to keep it going long term."
"And if the play fails?"
"Then the theatre closes down. Poor Taylor will be out of work and the Modernist faces the bulldozers. He told me he's already been approached by a chain hotel who are after the land as it's such a prime spot on the seafront. Actually, he was the one who recommended the Seaview to the cast. That's why they're staying here. They were supposed to go into theatre digs, but there's a problem with mice in the kitchen and they've had to close until it's sorted. All being well, the actors will move there 2 weeks today, on the morning the play opens."
"Mice in the kitchen?"
Jean wrinkled her nose in disgust. "Anyway," Helen carried on, "they can't rehearse at the Modernist until the leaking roof's fixed, and that's why they're rehearsing here."
"Here? In the lounge?"
Jean frowned, looking around. "And the dining room and hall. I expect they'll use as much free space as they can. When the booking came in, it was a posh woman who made it, said she was personal assistant to Mr. Richard Dawley, Esquire. I mean, who calls themselves Esquire these days? She referred to the actors as creative artists and warned they could be temperamental. Creative types might have fragile egos, I guess."
"And only 7 are coming, you say?"
"Yes, only 7 breakfasts for you to cook for the next 2 weeks, so your workload should be nice and light." Helen bit her lip, remembering something else she had to tell Jean. "Oh, but there's something you should know." She paused before delivering the news she knew Jean wouldn't like. "One of them is vegan."
"Vegan?"
Jean sucked air through her teeth. In all the years she'd worked at the Seaview, her full English breakfasts were consistently highly praised in reviews. They were renowned for their quality and quantity, and had even won the hotel an award for best breakfast on the Yorkshire coast. Jean took her work seriously. The range of items she cooked was limited, admittedly, but they were always cooked very well. Helen had recently, and very gently, encouraged her to add porridge and grilled kippers to her repertoire. After an initial resistance, Jean was now adept at cooking both, although she still swore under her breath when kippers were requested. However, there was something far worse for her to contend with than kippers. What she couldn't understand were guests who didn't eat meat. She'd been raised on meat and 2 veg, and if it was good enough for her, why wasn't it good enough for the Seaview's guests? She took a deep breath, laid her hands on the table, and gave Helen's breakfast bombshell some thought.
"Vegan, eh? Well, I'm sure I could give them an extra slice of toast with beans and eggs."
"No eggs," Helen said quickly. Jean looked like she'd been slapped.
"No eggs?"
Helen shook her head. "Vegans don't eat meat, eggs, or any dairy products."
"Then what on earth will I give them?" Jean cried.
"There's a box of vegan sausages in the freezer. You can grill a couple of those with beans and toast."
Jean blanched. "Vegan sausages? They're an abomination, that's what they are."
"And that's not all," Helen continued. "Another of the guests is on a special low-fat diet. I've bought plenty of soy milk and skimmed milk, plus yogurts, low-fat."
Jean threw her hands in the air in desperation. "Low-fat? Why does anyone want low-fat food when they're on holiday? They're here to enjoy themselves."
"This lot will be working, Jean. They're not coming on holiday. Besides, we've always made a point of catering to guests' special requests. It's part of our requirements as a 3-star hotel. And when we get our 4 stars, it'll be even more important."
"Don't count your chickens before they hatch, love," Jean said sagely. "I wouldn't want you to be disappointed."
Helen furrowed her brow. "What makes you think we won't get upgraded? I've followed the rules for accreditation to the letter. In fact, I almost went cross-eyed double-checking them. All we need now is for the hotel inspector to pay us a visit and give us their official report. I might even be able to start charging more for the rooms when..."
"If," Jean chipped in,
"when we get the extra star."
Jean slapped her hand against her forehead.
Oh, now you've mentioned the inspector, I've got something to tell you.
What is it?
You know my friend Gloria, who cleans at the Royal Hotel? Well, she heard on the grapevine that the inspectors have started doing their rounds on the coast. Apparently, the one who inspected the Royal was a woman called Jane Jones, who booked in for one night to give the place a once-over before she completed her report.
Helen was shocked to hear this. Gloria told you the inspector's name, but they're supposed to be anonymous.
There's not much gets past hoteliers around here. You should know that by now, Jean said. When there's news as big as an inspector at large, you can bet that word passes on.
Helen thought about this for a moment.
Miriam next door at the Vista del Mar usually lets me know about such things. You know what she's like, always up on the latest hotelier's gossip, but she's never said a word about this. Are you sure Gloria got it right?
Before Jean could reply, Helen's phone rang.
Oh, the number's withheld, she said, before swiping the screen and announcing herself. However, there was no reply.
Hello, she repeated.
Seaview Hotel, can I help you?
There was a beat of dead air before a woman's voice broke the silence.
Stay away from him.
The line went dead.
Helen glared at the phone, an uneasy feeling settling in the pit of her stomach.
Who was it? Jean asked.
She was about to reply when her attention was caught by a white minibus pulling up outside. Along the middle of the bus, the two masks of tragedy and comedy were painted with the words Dawley's Theatre Group.
Jean, they're here, she said.
Jean bustled out of the room. Then I'll go downstairs to put the kettle on for our coffee while you check them in.
Helen stood, watching the minibus doors open and those inside tumble out.
She counted only 6 people, not 7 as Taylor had promised, 4 women and 2 men. 2 of the women looked around Jean's age, ladies of a certain vintage who carried themselves with grace and style. They were both smartly dressed, one clad head to toe in black, a long leather coat, well-cut trousers and boots, the other wearing a 3/4 white coat with a pale blue pashmina thrown over her shoulder. The pair walked across the road to take in the stunning view of the beach, but Helen noticed they kept well apart. The rest of the group appeared to be much younger. The man who'd been driving stood on the pavement, stretching his arms and back. He was tall and lean, with dark hair. Good-looking, too, Helen noticed, with a dark beard and moustache. The second man, younger than the driver, was tall and skinny, dressed in an unflattering beige anorak and seemed unsure what to do. He hovered by the minibus as the two younger women, one wearing a red cap over short brown hair, the other with long blonde hair, both pulled their phones from their handbags. Helen glanced at her own phone, wondering who had called, before quickly dismissing it as a wrong number. The Seaview's doorbell rang and she stood, pushed her shoulders back and made her way to the hallway. She quickly checked her reflection in the mirror on the wall.
Not looking bad, Mrs. Dexter, she said out loud, slipping her phone into her jeans pocket.
She put a welcoming smile on her face and pulled the door open to greet her theatrical guests.
Chapter 2.
Welcome to the Seaview. Come in, Helen said, holding the green door open. In front of her was the minibus driver. He was tall, distinguished-looking, with piercing blue eyes and dark eyebrows to match his thick, lustrous hair. A pair of faded blue jeans covered his long, muscled legs. He wore black leather loafers, a white shirt under a black jacket, and a beaming smile.
I'm Chester Ford, playwright, director, lead actor. How do you do? He said.
His deep, husky voice fitted the look of him perfectly. He extended a hand to Helen. In his other, he held an old-fashioned black cigarette holder that was more than a foot long. Helen was relieved to see it was empty, as the last thing she wanted was to have crosswords with her new guest when he'd only just arrived. She smiled warmly and shook his hand. Chester swung around and extended his cigarette holder towards the 5 people behind him.
And this is my little troop of merry men and women who've joined Dawley's Theatre Group for my special Scarborough play.
Helen stepped back from the door to allow him to enter. As the rest of the group arrived at the door with their luggage, Chester introduced each one.
It was clear to Helen from the way he confidently took the lead that he liked to be in charge. The young, skinny man wearing the beige anorak and a worried expression stepped into the hallway first. Chester pointed at him with his cigarette holder.
"This is Paul McNally, who looks after our behind-the-scenes work. Props, lighting, you name it, Paul does it. We'd be lost without him. He's the glue that keeps us together."
"You don't act?" Helen asked. Paul lifted his gaze from the carpet and looked at her briefly, then shook his head and shuffled awkwardly past Chester. Next was one of the two elegantly dressed older ladies Helen had spied from the window. She had stylishly cropped grey hair, and although her face was lined with age, she looked relaxed and carefree. She reminded Helen of the women in holiday adverts for cruises for the over-60s.
"You might recognise Audrey Monroe. She's a theatrical star," Chester said proudly, waving his cigarette holder.
Helen scanned the woman's soft features, but was unable to connect her to anything she'd seen.
"Oh, Chester, stop teasing,"
Audrey said. Her voice was soft and serene. She leaned towards Helen.
"Yes, I was big once, but that was decades ago. Another lifetime, really. Probably before you were born. I've devoted my whole life to treading the boards."
She glided along the hallway to stand beside Paul as Chester waved in the next person. A young, attractive woman dressed in a bright red jumpsuit and yellow ankle boots bounded into the hallway. Her blonde hair fell to her shoulders. She grasped Helen's hand and shook it heartily.
"Kate Barnes," she said, before Chester could announce her. "I'm an actress, singer and model and training to become a children's TV presenter."
Helen admired her energy.
"Nice to meet you."
Chester tuttered loudly.
"Kate, dear, you should know better than to call yourself an actress. You're an actor, darling, an actor. You're not in some provincial Amdram group now. Dawley's Theatre Group is a professional outfit."
Kate shimmied along the hall to join Audrey and Paul.
"Next we have the lovely Liza," Chester said, waving his cigarette holder in circles.
The young woman in the red cap stepped through the door. There was something about her that looked familiar to Helen, but she couldn't quite place it at first. It was when Liza spoke that she made the obvious connection. Her voice was soft and calm, her features relaxed and serene. Her red cap sat atop short brown hair that feathered around her delicate features.
"I'm Audrey's daughter," she explained.
"Of course, the resemblance is startling," Helen said, turning from Liza to Audrey. Liza whipped off her cap and bowed.
"Liza Carter, actor and costume lady. That's Liza with a Z."
She strode along the hallway to stand next to her mum, and Audrey laid her arm around Liza's shoulders. Chester cleared his throat, then, with a regal wave, he gestured with his cigarette holder once more. This time it flew dangerously close to Helen's right eye, and she determined to have a quiet word with him later.
"And last, but by no means least, it's our leading lady and star of the show, the one and only Miss Carmen Del Rey."
Helen peered out of the door to see the woman dressed all in black. She clocked her expensive-looking boots and long trench coat. The coat had shoulder pads that made her look more physically robust than she was. She wore a black beret atop a mass of black curls that fell to her shoulders. In fact, she had so much hair that Helen thought it must be a wig, for surely no one her age would boast such a luxuriant mane. She had never seen such an extraordinary-looking woman before. Carmen was wearing heavy makeup and was undeniably attractive. She was of average height but whippet thin, and she reminded Helen of an aging American TV star from a soap opera she was struggling to name. She was incredibly glamorous, and if it hadn't been for the lines on her face, which no amount of makeup could ever hide, along with the shadows under her eyes showing a life well lived, Helen would have pegged her for a lot younger than she really was. A pair of smoky eyes flashed at her, and a perfect scarlet smile beamed from Carmen's lips. As Chester offered his hand to help her into the hallway, she pulled her arm sharply away.
"I don't want your help," she hissed.
Helen felt a twinge of embarrassment at being caught in their crossfire. Chester stepped back and stroked his moustache with his free hand, while Carmen stayed where she was, looking around.
"Is this really the best place you could book us into, Chester?"
Helen's jaw dropped in shock. She'd never felt so affronted.
"Now look here," she began,
but her words were cut off by Chester, who laid his hand on her arm while pointing his cigarette holder at Carmen.
I'm sure Carmen didn't mean what she said. She's just overtired from the journey, he said apologetically.
And she's in one of her moods, Kate added quickly.
Helen took a moment to pull herself together. She shrugged Chester's hand from her arm, then smiled sweetly at Carmen.
I'll have you know, the Seaview is a quality hotel, Mrs. Del Rey, she said firmly. Taylor Caffrey wouldn't have recommended it to you if he didn't approve.
Carmen grimaced. I'll be the judge of what I think is quality, she replied archly. Oh, and it's not Mrs. I'm not married.
I'm surprised she can keep up with whether she's single or married with all the men in her life, Kate sniggered behind Helen's back.
Helen counted to 5 in her head, calming herself down, then looked around at the guests.
Well, as we're going to be sharing the Seaview for the next 2 weeks, the least I can do is make sure I know everyone's name from the off.
She nodded to the lady with the blue pashmina, kind eyes and serene face. You're Audrey Monroe, right? She turned to the younger woman, the double of Audrey. Liza Carter, Audrey's daughter. The red jumpsuit and yellow boots couldn't be missed. Kate Barnes, she went on.
Chester Ford, nodding to the man with a moustache and beard.
At your service at all times, Chester replied, twirling his cigarette holder, an affectation which Helen was already finding annoying.
Peter? Helen said, looking at the boy in the beige anorak.
He shuffled from foot to foot, but didn't look up.
Paul, he said softly. Paul McNally. Ah, sorry, Paul, yes.
Finally, she turned to the woman in the leather coat. And Carmen Del Rey, of course. She didn't think she'd forget Carmen's name. The woman was one of the most unusual who'd ever stayed at the Seaview. She was old, yes, but there was an energy about her, and she certainly knew how to make an impression. She'd walked into the hotel with her head held high, even while criticising the place. Despite Carmen's sharp words about the Seaview, Helen was intrigued by her. It looked as if she was going to be a force to be reckoned with, and Helen knew she'd need to be on her mettle whenever she was around. Helen shook her head, pulled herself together, then led everyone to the lounge, where she handed out room keys.
"Now then, which one of you requested the vegan breakfast?" she asked.
Kate's hand shot up.
"I've had a word with the cook," Helen said, although she kept quiet about the words Jean had replied with. "Is there another person to come? Taylor Caffrey told me there would be 7 of you checking in, but only 6 have arrived."
"Ah, yes, about that," Chester said. He tapped his cigarette holder noisily on the bar. Helen gently placed her hand on his to deaden the noise. Despite his debonair appearance, she was beginning to find Chester Ford and his cigarette holder irritating, what with him constantly tapping and twirling the thing.
"This is a non-smoking hotel, Mr. Ford," she said calmly, removing her hand.
"What, this little thing?" Chester laughed, raising the holder. "Oh, I don't smoke it, I poke it."
"You do what?" Helen said sharply. As well as being irritating, she wondered if he was now having a joke at her expense.
"I poke things with it. See, I used to smoke," Chester explained. "And when I gave up, I found that I was so used to having this darling little thing between my fingers that I now carry it just to have something to do with my hands."
A burst of sarcastic laughter rang out. Helen turned, surprised to discover the outburst coming from Carmen.
She waited a moment, expecting an explanation, but none came her way. There were a few seconds of embarrassed silence before, professional to the end, she plastered her smile on and turned back to Chester.
"So, is there someone else coming?"
"Yes, another of our troupe will be arriving later, Lee Cooper."
"Worse luck," Kate muttered,
just loud enough for Helen to hear. As the actors made their way to their rooms, Helen noticed Chester and Carmen hanging back in the lounge, whispering. A black suitcase stood on the hallway floor.
"Is this yours, Carmen? Let me carry it up to your room," she called.
"Let me, I'll take it up for her," Chester replied.
Carmen glared at him.
"There's nothing you can do for me anymore," she hissed. "You and I are over. You knew we were finished when I signed up with Dawley's for this tour of your stinking play."
Chester noisily tapped his cigarette holder on the bar. It sounded to Helen as if a machine gun was going off in the lounge.
"This stinking play, as you call it, is my murder mystery masterpiece, Midnight with Maud."
Carmen crossed her arms. "Your masterpiece! How dare you!"
Carmen, we've been through this already. We've talked about it and agreed not to mention it again. You mean you paid me to shut up about it? Can't we try to be civil at least? Chester pleaded.
Helen lugged the suitcase from the hallway, leaving the two of them arguing. By the time she returned, Chester was outside, pulling a suitcase from the minibus. Carmen was holding a small round mirror in one hand, a scarlet lipstick in the other. Helen watched as she puckered up.
Are you all right? Need anything? She asked.
Carmen snapped the mirror shut, flung it in her bag with the lipstick, then smacked her scarlet lips together.
Oh, I'm more than all right, she said, sounding bitter. But I doubt very much there's anything either you or your dump of a hotel can offer me, whether I need it or not.
Now, just a minute, Helen said angrily, but Carmen stood, flicked her leather coat behind her, and stormed out of the lounge.
Helen let her go, relieved to get the woman out of her sight. She turned to the framed photograph of Tom behind the bar.
Well, what do you make of this lot? She said.
Her eye was caught by something next to the photo that made her smile. It was a plastic figurine of Elvis Presley, a tiny, fun ornament, no bigger than 3 inches high. Jimmy and his troupe of Elvis impersonators had presented it to her when they'd stayed at the Seaview earlier that year. They'd called it her good luck charm.
Well, Elvis, here's to the next 2 weeks with this acting group. They're quite a bunch of characters. I think I'm going to need some of your luck.
She pressed his plastic head and his hips shimmied from side to side. Just then, her phone rang. She picked it up, glanced at the screen, and saw that it was another withheld number. She swiped the phone into life, wondering who it was this time.
Good morning, Seaview Hotel, she said cheerfully.
However, the reply she heard knocked the smile off her face, and she stood to attention.
One night, she gulped. You'd like to book a room in the name of Jane Jones? Yes, I'm sure that'd be fine. Let me just check the diary.
She took the tablet from behind the bar and opened the app she used to book guests in. Jane Jones wanted a room for a week on Monday, while the actors would still be there. Helen briefly considered asking her to choose another date, but if she lost her slot with the inspector, she might have to wait months for another. No, she wasn't prepared to wait. She needed to act quickly. The acting troupe were only using 7 guest rooms, plus 1 extra to store props and costumes. That left 2 rooms spare. She hadn't signed anything with Taylor Caffrey to prohibit her from taking other guests while the actors were there, although she knew they wouldn't be overjoyed once they found out. Well, she'd crossed that bridge when she came to it. This was an exceptional booking, one she wasn't prepared to refuse. Decision made, she went ahead and booked in Jane Jones. When she hung up, she breathed a sigh of relief and looked again at the photo of Tom. He was dressed as Elvis Presley, his musical hero, wearing a white suit, black wig, and quivering top lip. The photo had been taken at one of the Seaview's famous Elvis-themed party nights, which they used to enjoy before Tom fell ill.
This could be it, Tom, she said. Finally, the Seaview gets its chance to shine.
Chapter 3.
Once the actors were in their rooms, Helen walked down to her basement apartment. A cafetiere of coffee sat on the kitchen table, along with a packet of chocolate digestives. Jean helped herself to a biscuit and dunked it in her mug. At Helen's feet, her greyhound Suki lay sphinx-like, her long caramel limbs neatly tucked under her body.
Did the actors check in all right? Jean asked.
Almost all of them, Helen replied. There's another arriving later.
She took a sip from her mug.
Strange bunch, though.
Jean raised her eyebrows.
How do you mean?
Helen shrugged. One of them is possibly the most glamorous woman we've ever had staying here, but she was also very rude. I picked up on some tension between her and a fella called Chester. They were arguing and whispering once the others were out of earshot. Chester's a good-looking man, maybe in his 30s. There's a mother and daughter, too. The mother is a big theatre star, apparently. She's called Audrey Munro. Have you heard of her?
Jean shook her head.
Can't say I have. Will you need me to stay after breakfast each day? Perhaps they'd like morning coffee and pastries or lunch? I could turn my hand to baking quiches and pies, if that's what they want.
Well, they've only booked in for bed and breakfast, but I'll ask them. It could be a money spinner if it works out.
Thanks, Jean. You always have the best ideas. Jean took another biscuit and dunked it in her coffee. What's she like, then, this rude woman who was arguing? The black-clad Carmen Del Rey flashed through Helen's mind. She's stylish, I'll give her that. Very well-dressed, classy, lots of makeup, gorgeous hair. She had a beret on, you know, looked a bit French. But my word, she had an attitude. I think staying here is a come-down for her. It sounds as if she's used to the finer things in life, and that doesn't include three-star B&Bs. Chester, the director, called her his leading lady. What's her name? Jean asked. Carmen Del Rey. Jean almost choked on her biscuit. She put her coffee cup on the table and covered her mouth with her hand, coughing and gasping for breath. Helen leapt out of her seat and thumped her on the back until her breathing returned to normal, then handed her a glass of water. Thanks, love, Jean gasped between sips. My word, that name's a blast from the past. She put her hand on her chest and leaned back in her chair. Do you know her? Helen asked. I used to, Jean said. Give me a minute, love, while I pull myself together. She took another biscuit and bit into it, washing it down with a sip of coffee. Then she leaned forward. We went to the same school, though she's a few years older than me. I remember her from when I was growing up in Hull, but she wasn't called Carmen back then. I knew her as Janet Carstairs. When did she change her name? When she left school and started studying drama in London. She never returned to Hull. I heard through friends that she thought the place wasn't good enough for her. Plus, she's been married at least three times, I'm aware of. She might be Miss Del Rey to her adoring fans, but to those who knew her back then, she'll always be Janet Carstairs. How old is she, Jean? Helen asked, intrigued. She'll be late 60s. I hope I look as good as her at that age. Well, I haven't seen her in years, not since Hull. I don't suppose she'll recognise me. What I do remember, though, a faraway look came into Jean's eyes, was that she used to flirt with one of our teachers, Mr. Gibson, the history master. He had a huge moustache, if I remember rightly. Chester Ford, the director, he's got a big moustache too, Helen noted. Do you think Chester and Carmen are carrying on? Jean asked. It's none of my business, Jean. You know I don't like gossiping about the guests, but this lot are very unusual. Is it all right if I come upstairs to say hello to her at some point? Of course it is. Any time. It was on the tip of Helen's tongue to tell Jean about the hotel inspector's visit when the doorbell rang. She glanced at the screen on the kitchen wall, which showed an image from the camera by the front door. A tall, thin, bald man was standing rigid, with a large sports bag at his feet. He had a long, pale face and thin lips, and was dressed in a formal black suit. That might be the final guest, she said. I'll go and check him in. Jean drained her coffee, then bent low to stroke Suki. The dog whined with pleasure in return. I'll let myself out and head up to the care home to see Mum. She's still having trouble with her legs. I'll be back in the morning to cook breakfast. See you, Jean. Thanks for everything, Helen said as she headed upstairs. Helen pulled the door open and greeted the man standing outside. Lee Cooper, he said, offering his hand. Then he pointed to the minibus. I'm with Dawley's theatre group. I see the others have arrived. Helen stepped to one side to allow him to enter. Yes, they're here. Please come in. Welcome to the Seaview Hotel. Did you have a good journey? Well, the train wasn't full, and I managed to get a seat in the quiet coach so I could start learning my lines. I sometimes have a bit of trouble with them, so the more practice I can get, the better. But it would have been easier if I'd travelled in the bus with the gang. Why didn't you? Helen asked, curious. Lee's face seemed to collapse in on itself, and his bottom lip trembled. My fiancé, well, she's my ex now. She's part of the troupe. We broke up recently, and things are still raw between us. Oh, dear, I'm sorry to hear it, Helen said. She wondered which of the female actors was Lee's ex-fiancé. Was it Liza or Kate? It wouldn't be Audrey, surely, would it? She was old enough to be the boy's grandmother. Oh, and please don't let it be Carmen, she thought. There was enough drama going on with that woman already. How Kate and I will manage to get through the next couple of weeks, working closely together and living in the same place, I don't know, but we have no choice, Lee continued. Kate? Ah, I see, Helen said, relieved that he'd answered her question without her having to ask it. She didn't like to probe into guests' affairs. Because both of us are actors, we're often broke between jobs. So when we were offered the chance to perform in Midnight with Maud, we jumped at it. Lee carried on. We were still together when we signed up with Dawley's for this play, and we were happy. Thought we had the world at our feet. And now things have gone wrong, and here we are, forced together. It's not going to be easy for either of us, Mrs.
Dexter, but please call me Helen.
She handed Lee the key to his room and offered to take his bag. She was relieved when he declined. His bag was big, looked heavy, and his room was on the top floor. With her afternoon free and the weather still mild, Helen decided to take Suki to the beach. She flung on her old fleece jacket, fastened Suki's lead to her collar, and led the dog out of the back door and into the yard. Turning the corner around the sea view, she walked down Windsor Terrace to King's Parade, and from there followed the path down the cliff to the beach. When she let Suki off the lead, the dog bounded to the waves, stopping short of going in and getting wet.
"Not going for a swim today, Suki?" Helen called.
The sun sparkled on the water, light bouncing like diamonds. Oh, how she loved Scarborough. She took off her jacket and tied the sleeves around her waist, exposing her arms. Then she closed her eyes, tilted her face to the sun, and let its warmth sink into her skin, breathing in the sea air as she listened to gulls and the breaking waves. She was still learning to claim Scarborough as her own. Since Tom's illness had taken him, her life had taken on a different tone. It felt empty now and subdued. After he died, she'd put all her energy, heart and soul, not to mention her bank balance, into the sea view, upgrading and decorating as she learned how to cope on her own. When she opened her eyes again, ahead of her was a stout woman with an ice cream in her hand. She was barefoot, paddling in the sea, the waves splashing her ankles. Her skirt reminded Helen of deck chair stripes as it billowed out. Her perfume reached her, the scent of freshly spun candy floss on the breeze. She looked happy, Helen thought, a woman in the prime of life, sun-kissed and smiling. All that was missing was a kiss-me-quick hat on her head. She wondered if the souvenir shops on the South Bay still sold hats like that. She hadn't seen one in years. When she'd walked for an hour, she returned to the sea view. Taking her phone from her pocket, she saw a missed call from her friend Taylor. She called him straight back.
"How are the actors settling in, dear?" he asked.
"Well, they're here," Helen said. "There's not much more I can tell you. They seem like a nice bunch."
"You'll get to know them pretty well over the next 2 weeks. The landlady at the theatre Diggs still can't take them till then. The mice have gone, but the inspector from the council has found something else."
"What?" Helen asked.
"Believe me, you don't want to know. Anywho, I hope it's all right that I landed the troop on you, because you're the one who has to look after them, feed them, and keep them energised, ready to perform. I should warn you, there are some big egos amongst them. Things might get intense."
"Oh, it's already intense," Helen laughed, thinking of Carmen.
"Not Kate and Lee," Taylor said. "I heard they'd split up. Can't be easy on either of them being forced to live together. I just hope it doesn't cause you too much grief having a fighting couple staying at the Seaview." He cleared his throat. "And how's Madam doing?"
"Do you mean Jean?"
"No, darling, I mean the dark diva, Carmen Del Rey."
"Oh, well, she's..." Helen tried to choose her words carefully. "She's unique, I'll give her that. I don't think I've met anyone like her before.
Just keep her away from the bar."
"Why? Does she have a drink problem?"
"You mean you don't know?"
"I'd never heard of her before she turned up today."
"Haven't you ever seen the singing nurse on TV?" Taylor cried. "Carmen was its star, darling. She lit up the screen each time she came on. She played Wendy Songbird Wren and was in almost every episode for 15 years. It made her a big name in television before she got sacked. You must have seen it, surely."
"I've never heard of it, Taylor. You know, I don't watch much TV. Running the Seaview takes up all my time. I'll Google it later."
"Why did they sack her?" "Well, therein lies a tale. She kept turning up drunk for work, and rumour has it that she only got the lead role in the first place after seducing the show's director. He was married, of course, and there's been bad blood between Carmen and Audrey since."
"What does Audrey have to do with it?" I can't believe you don't know, dear. Everyone in our business knows what happened.
Helen laughed. I'm a hotel landlady, Taylor, not involved in your creative world.
Well, you know me, I'm not one to gossip, but as it's common knowledge already, there's no harm in letting you know. Carmen seduced Audrey's husband. Not only that, but she also took Audrey's role in the singing nurse.
You mean the role was meant for Audrey?
That's exactly right, dear. After it happened, Audrey disappeared from acting for a very long time. The official line was that she'd taken herself away to a meditation retreat in the Pyrenees, but others, shall we say less kind people, maintain she had a breakdown and couldn't face the world. I guess we'll never learn the truth about what really went on. I still can't believe they both agreed to join Dawley's theatre group for this performance, knowing that they'd be working with each other. But actors always go where the work is, even when it means reuniting with an old enemy. Anyway, I thought it best to warn you that things might get ugly. Carmen isn't known for her discretion and tact.
She's going to keep me on my toes, that one, Helen agreed.
And how does Audrey seem? Taylor asked.
Oh, she's lovely, very zen and chilled.
Don't let appearances fool you. Remember, these are acting professionals, dear. I know what they're like. I've spent my whole life amongst thespians.
There was a beat of silence before Taylor spoke again.
Helen, dear, he said, lowering his voice, you will look after the actors, won't you? Midnight with Maud is make or break for the modernist. You know how much Scarborough folk love to see a good show. If the play doesn't pull a decent-sized audience, the theatre closes down. It's as simple as that. Running the modernist is my life. It's all I've ever known. The place is crumbling around my ears, but I'm determined to save it.
I'll look after your troupe, Taylor. Don't worry. How are the roof repairs going?
Good. I've got your friend Gav working on it, Taylor said brightly. He can talk the back legs of a pantomime horse, but he's doing a great job.
If Gav's on the case, it'll be done well. He's a hard worker, and the modernist is safe in his hands, or at least the roof is.
Anywho, I'd better go. Mr. Phipps needs his dinner, and I've bought him a tin of luxury tuna chunks.
How is the old fella?
Getting old and fat, just like me.
Helen said goodbye, but before she put her phone away, she decided to search online to find out more about the singing nurse and the enigmatic Carmen Del Rey.
Chapter 4. It was all systems go the next morning while breakfast was being prepared. In the kitchen, Jean sang along to a 60s hit on the radio as she placed hash browns on a tray. Helen didn't want to get in her way while she worked. She knew Jean's routine off by heart and knew the woman didn't like anyone to fuss around. Instead, she took Sookie for a walk along the North Bay beach. As she returned to the Seaview, she spotted Sally on Windsor Terrace. Sally was the hotel's cleaner, at least that was what it said on her job description. In reality, she was so much more, helping out in every way she could. The only thing she didn't do, that Jean wouldn't allow anyone to do, was help with the cooking. She was a determined young woman in her early 30s, slim with shoulder-length fair hair, and when she wasn't working at the Seaview, she was studying business and law at Scarborough College. She was also a single mother to 4-year-old Gracie and a good friend to Helen and Jean. The three women formed a tight-knit, efficient bond.
"Morning, Sally," Helen called cheerfully. "How are you?" "A bit tired, if I'm honest. I was out with Gav last night. We went to a Northern Soul gig at the Spa and didn't get home till late. But it was a great night. Brilliant music, Helen. You should come with us one night."
Sally put her hand to her mouth to stifle a yawn. Helen glanced at her pale face.
"You do look done in. I'll ask Jean to make us coffee before we start serving breakfast." "The acting troupe have arrived, I see," Sally said, pointing at the minibus. "Oh, they're here. You'll meet them at breakfast."
"Nice bunch?"
"Nice enough,"
Helen replied, putting an end to further questions. Sally got down on her haunches and stroked Suki's head, making a fuss of the dog.
"How's Gracie?" Helen asked.
"She's fallen in love with Gav," Sally laughed, standing up. "He's all she talks about. It's Gav this and Gav that. On the nights when he doesn't stay over at the flat, she's asking where he is. It's tricky, Helen. I think the world of him, but I'm scared of bringing him into Gracie's life full-time.
He might just disappear like her dad did, once the novelty wears off and the reality of having a child sinks in.
Gav wouldn't do that, Helen said quickly.
Wouldn't he?
How do you know what goes on in his mind?
He's a mate of Marie's, and she's been my best friend since we were little. She thinks the sun shines out of him, and he can do no wrong in her eyes, and I trust her judgment. If Marie thinks Gav's a good'un, he is. She's rarely wrong about men.
Apart from her husband, you mean? What a mistake he turned out to be.
Helen rolled her eyes. The least said about Darren Clark, the better. And just for the record, she's gone back to using her maiden name now she's divorced. She's not Marie Clark anymore. She's Marie Davenport.
Makes her sound like a character in a period drama.
Helen laughed. Oh, Marie would love that, wouldn't she? I can just see her now as Lady Davenport of the Manor. The two women walked to the back of the Seaview and let themselves in through the yard.
Come through to my living room, Helen told Sally. I'll bring coffee in to perk you up. We've got half an hour before breakfast begins.
They made their way through the kitchen, greeting Jean en route, but knowing not to stop and distract her. In the living room, Sally settled on the sofa with Suki's head on her knee, while Helen returned to the kitchen to fetch two steaming cups of coffee.
Before we start work, I've got a couple of things to tell you, she said, as she passed Sally a chunky blue mug.
The first thing is that we've got a special visitor coming a week on Monday and staying just for one night.
Who?
Brace yourself, Sally. It's the hotel inspector. Sally punched the air with her free hand.
At least we'll get our 4 stars.
Then she leaned towards Helen.
Aren't they supposed to be anonymous? How do you know?
Jean's got a friend who works at the Royal Hotel, and she heard on the grapevine that a female inspector called Jane Jones is doing the rounds on the Yorkshire coast. Next thing you know, I receive a phone call from a woman for a single night's booking.
Let me guess, in the name of Jane Jones?
Got it in one.
Oh, Helen, this is great news. You deserve that extra star.
We all deserve it, you, me, and Jean.
Does Jean know yet? Sally asked.
No. I was about to tell her when a guest arrived. I'll tell her after breakfast, when we have our daily catch-up. But seriously, Sally, I couldn't have got the hotel up to scratch without your help, and without Jean agreeing to expand the breakfast menu. Well, and without Marie's investment, of course. She's the one who encouraged me to update the place after Tom died. She thought it'd be a distraction for me, but now that it's done, I can see she was right. It did look dated and dull before.
It really does look much nicer now, Helen. It feels light and airy, and the muted colours in the dining room are a touch of genius.
Did she plough all of her divorce settlement into the Seaview? Helen shook her head. Not all of it. Marie's savvy enough not to put all her eggs in one basket. She invested enough to get this place looking smart, and she's been true to her word so far and hasn't interfered in the business. She said she only ever wanted to be a sleeping partner, and that's what she's done. She'll get a good return on her money, I'll see to that. And your Gav did a wonderful job decorating it with a team of lads he brought in. They were really fast workers.
So what's the second thing I need to know? Sally asked.
Just that we have 7 guests here for the next 2 weeks, apart from the night when the inspector comes. Oh, and one of them is vegan. Sally laughed out loud.
I bet Jean's not happy about that.
Happy about what? Jean said, walking into the living room carrying 2 plates. Here we go. Hot bacon butties to get your engines revving before you start serving breakfast. Helen and Sally each took a plate.
I was just telling Sally about the vegan, Helen said, winking at Sally.
Jean padded out of the living room, muttering darkly under her breath. Half an hour later, Helen and Sally were waiting by the dining room door. Both wore a smart navy tabard with the Seaview's name embroidered in white. It was Chester Ford who came down first, and Helen was relieved to see he didn't have his cigarette holder.
Morning, Chester. This is Sally, my right-hand woman. If you or the troop need anything, all you have to do is ask. We'll do all we can to help.
Chester ran his fingers through his thick, dark hair.
Thank you, he said.
Oh, hasn't he got a lovely deep voice? Sally whispered to Helen.
Audrey and Liza came down together, chatting amiably. Helen stole a quick look at Audrey, remembering what Taylor Caffrey had told her about her fallout with Carmen all those years ago.
She wondered if, behind her calm facade, Audrey still bore a grudge. Then came Paul, avoiding her gaze, mumbling good morning in reply to her cheery hello. "He's a bit shy," she whispered to Sally once Paul was seated. Next to enter the dining room was Kate, dressed in another colourful jumpsuit, this time turquoise, matched with snow-white trainers. She was the most energetic and alert of the group, greeting Helen loudly, telling her what a wonderful room she had and how well she'd slept. She was followed by Carmen, who looked every inch as glamorous as she'd done the previous day. Helen wondered what time she set her morning alarm for to give her time to do her face and fix her hair. Or was it a wig? She still wasn't sure. Carmen wafted into the dining room without acknowledging Helen or Sally, and Helen caught the scent of dark, heady perfume as she walked by. She watched the woman hesitate at the door.
"Feel free to sit anywhere you'd like to," she said.
Carmen chose a table at the opposite end of the room to the others. Not only that, but she positioned herself so that her back was towards them, which Helen thought rather rude. Last downstairs was Lee, who paused at the dining room door, peeked inside, then smiled wanly at Helen.
"Would you mind seating me away from Kate? I don't want to upset her by sitting close by."
"You can sit anywhere you want. There are plenty of free tables," Helen replied. Lee walked slowly into the room where muted good mornings were exchanged, but Carmen still refused to turn around. Helen and Sally got to work bringing in Jean's breakfasts, cooked to perfection. All except Kate's vegan sausages, which were cooked as well as Jean could manage. Small talk was exchanged between tables as the guests ate, although Carmen didn't join in, concentrating instead on a sheaf of papers in front of her. Each time Helen brought more tea or toast, she tried to peek at Carmen's reading material. Well, it wasn't as if she was being nosy, or so she told herself, for the bold typeface wasn't hard to miss. It was the script for Midnight with Maud. She also couldn't help notice Carmen's nails, which were long, sharp, and painted a deep shade of red.
"Are you starting rehearsals today?" Helen asked Chester when she served him more tea.
"No, today is a day for settling in," he replied. "We'll begin rehearsals tomorrow, in your bar lounge, if we may. Taylor Caffrey said you'd offered us as much of your public area as we might need."
"No trouble at all. Make yourselves at home," Helen replied.
The group ate at leisure, and when they finally left the dining room, Helen noticed that Lee kept his distance from Kate, who refused to look in his direction. Only Carmen was left in the room, reading her script, and without glasses too. Helen wondered what woman of that age didn't need reading specs. Carmen might be rude and unpredictable, but physically she was a marvel for her age.
"More tea?" Helen asked.
Carmen leaned back in her seat. "I'm all done, dear. Thank you. Breakfast was delicious. Please give my regards to your cook."
An idea struck Helen.
"You could give her your compliments yourself, if you like. She's someone you might recognise."
Carmen's face dropped before she forced a smile.
"Really? Oh, who on earth could it be?" she cooed.
"Sally," Helen called.
"Be a love. Pop downstairs and ask Jean to come up."
Within minutes, Jean was walking towards the dining room door.
"What is it? Any problems with breakfast?" she asked.
"On the contrary," Helen said, smiling. "There's someone here who'd like to say thank you."
Puzzled, Jean put her head around the door. Her eyes opened wide.
"My word, it really is you."
Carmen didn't move, and her face gave nothing away. Jean hesitated.
"It's me, Jean Atkinson from Hull," she said. "Don't you remember me? Chubby little Jean? Oh, I was such a fan of the singing nurse. I loved you in that show as Wendy Songbird Wren. Mind you, I'm old enough to remember you as Janet Carstairs."
Carmen's top lip curled, and quick as a flash, she whipped a pair of large sunglasses from her bag and snapped them onto her face. Helen watched, intrigued.
"Janet Carstairs is a part of my life I never discuss," Carmen hissed. "I have no wish to dig her up from the dead."
She scraped her chair back, gathered her script and bag, and stormed from the room, almost knocking Jean over as she went. When she was out of earshot, Jean sidled up.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.